And he didn't want to harm him or kill him or anything like that, because he was telling, John the Baptist was like Jesus Christ. He was telling the truth. And so Herod was like, okay, you know, like, we'll just leave John the Baptist in prison. And whenever I want to listen to John the Baptist, I'll go down to the jail and kind of hear him out with what he has to say. But then what happened at that moment was that, you know, one day Herod was throwing a party, and Herod's daughter, Herodias, and then her daughter came around, and Herod said, okay, well, I could give you the head of anybody who you like to kill. And they said, well, kill for me John the Baptist. So Herod killed John the Baptist. He took off his head. And you know, Herod didn't want to do that, but that was the promise that he promised Herodias and her daughter. And that's the same thing with God, you know. And so this is kind of like a symbol of what God does. God promises in the beginning to judge. And so basically, like, he has a certain set of commandments called the law. And the law is not like our country's law or our human laws. His laws are much higher than our laws. You know, the Bible says that in Isaiah that, seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and to my God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. So if we look through the commandments of Jesus, you know, it says that if you look at another person with lust, you have already committed adultery. It does say that if you hate somebody in your heart, you have already committed adultery. And it even says, like, if you swear to God that you're going to do something and fail to perform an oath, you're in danger of false witness or lying before God. And lying towards another person in dishonesty also will send you straight to hell. It's a violation of God's commandment. And so it's if you steal something or you covet something, if you want something that's not rightfully yours, you know, you're basically condemned by the law. So as you can see here, you know, the subtle things in our heart are one of the things that God looks at. You know, the world may tell you to trust in yourself or to trust in your heart, but that's a big fat lie from the devil. The Bible says that the heart is desperately wicked above all things. Who can know it? And you know, in the book of James in the New Testament, it says that the Bible is like a mirror to our soul. But if we fail to trust in the Bible and to obey the Bible, you know, the book of James says that we're like a person who looks at our face in the mirror and forgets how we look like in the mirror. So don't be a fool. The Bible says to take heed to the word of God. And whoever has ears, let them hear. And the Bible says that if you hear the voice of God, do not harden your hearts as the children of Israel did in the days of rebellion. So those are the things that we need to take hold of. We need to lay hold of. We need to understand the condition of our human nature. We need to understand the character of God. And yes, the goodness of God does lead us to repentance. But the problem is that many people want to always talk about the good side of God and not the goodness and severity of God. And in another sense, you know, it's scary that God is good because it shows us how unrighteous we are. Like when we go to the book of Isaiah, you know, when Isaiah the prophet first met God, you know, he's like, woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips. And that was exactly how I came to Jesus Christ. You know, three to 4 years ago, you know, I used to be a practicing homosexual. I used to be in the New Age movement. You know, I used to watch gay pornography 3 or 4 times a day. And because of my homosexual lifestyle, I became the most popular kid in my Japanese class. You know, because I was promoting that sin. So everybody liked me because I was promoting the ways of the world. But, you know, and I hated God. When I first read the Bible, when this Japanese-American ministry called Eden Media first showed me the Bible, you know, in both Japanese and English, I totally hated the Bible. You know why I hated the Bible? It's because it was convicting me of my sins. God showed me Matthew 5:28, where it says that if you look at lust, you have committed adultery. So that convicted me of my porn watching. And when I read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, that convicted me of my lifestyle and homosexuality. And then I found out in John 14:6 that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to God but by me. And when Jesus Christ revealed that, I was very upset at Jesus Christ because, you know, in the New Age movement, I was doing yoga and meditation But I believe that all roads lead to God, that we're all children of God, but Jesus Christ was saying otherwise. He said that, you know, the only way is Jesus Christ. And I thought, oh, how intolerant of those Christians. But at that point, I didn't realize that I was the one that was intolerant too, because I wanted everybody to believe that all roads lead to God. And I thought that, you know, the people who thought that all roads lead to God or all roads lead home, the people who thought that were the only right people or the only good people, you know, and deep down in my heart. So, you know, but anyways, you know, I ran away from God. I ran away from the conviction of sin. And God showed me a glimpse of hell. And one of the things is that I believe that God showed me hell. And when I was in hell, I knew that I deserved to be there. So at the moment I was in the gates of hell, when God pulled me out of my body and sent me to the gates of hell, this literal place that Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 16, you know, I knew that I deserved to be there. So I believe that at that point in my life, you know, when God showed me hell, you know, I believe that I encountered the goodness of God, because I'm like, wow, I deserve to be here because of my sins. I have the revelation about the righteousness of God. But the thing is that, you know, one of the things that people like to think is that they could achieve their way to God, that somehow by doing good enough things that they could be good enough to enter into the kingdom of God. But that's not true, because Isaiah chapter 64 verses 6 says, all our righteousness is as filthy rags. So that means none of the good things that we do in this life, whether we're a good father, a good child, a good co-worker, a good teacher, you know, see, none of the good things that we do are ever good enough to God. And so that's the very serious thing, is that, you see, even though we try to be good, we can't match the standard of goodness that God calls us to. And also the other problem is that our good deeds cannot pay off for the things that we've done wrong against God. And, you know, the Bible says that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So each and every one of us, whether or not we realize it, has sinned against God at one point in their life or another. But sometimes we don't want to remember the things that we've done wrong to God. We try to suppress the truth and unrighteousness. And that's a very serious thing. Or sometimes we're like the Pharisees. You know, we think that we're more better than we truly are. And that's called self-righteousness. And that comes from a place of pride. And pride makes us delusional. And God's a God of truth. He hates lies. And it says in the Bible that pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit goes before a fall. So we can't be prideful in our approach to God. Like my brother G was saying earlier, you know, in the Gospels, in I believe Luke chapter 15, there's one person who says, well, God, you know, I'm not like the tax collectors. I'm not like those dirty sinners out there on the streets, like these prostitutes, these murderers, these people in jail, you know, so I'm not like them, so I should be good. But that's not true at all. You know, that's not true at all. Because the thing is that, you know, that, and then the person who said, woe is me, for I'm a sinner, I need God. You know, that's the person who was forgiven by God. So that's the thing, though. When we approach God, we need to do that. We need to acknowledge and to confess our sins. You know, it says that he who confesses their sins and forsakes them shall have mercy. So the thing is that you can't love God if you love your sins more. The Bible says that he who seeks to save his life will lose it, but he who loses his life for my sake and the gospel's sake shall find it. So when you approach God, you know, God could present you, you know, like J. Warner Wallace and the people that Brother G was presenting earlier, you know, you could be presented with all the evidence of the world about why Jesus is the only way, you know, about the consistency, why the Bible is reliable. You know, there's 25,000 manuscripts, high consistency rate across the board, high percentage of consistency rate, eyewitness testimonies that's credible, that were written when the eyewitnesses of Jesus Christ's resurrection were alive. You know, I can present to you all the evidence in the world, but at the end of the day, it comes down to you denying yourself, giving up the pleasures that you have in this world. You know, and also, you know, I need to say that, when I came to Christ, you know, I wanted to go to Harvard, and I became born again. I wanted to go to Columbia University and become the best Japanese English translator in the United States. But God told me to forsake that dream and go study his Bible, so I did. And then a year after I studied the Bible in English, God gave me a Japanese Bible. And then he said, go preach the gospel in America and Japan. So all I want to say to you is seek after the truth and you will find it. That's what's commanded in the Bible. Praise Jesus. Amen.